Welcome you to the next session of embedded software testing. This is the exercise and questions and practical sessions of series of embedded software testing. Here we see more practical aspects of embedded software testing in terms of exercises, walkthrough videos, tools, demonstrations, and followed by questions and few answers, and I will post some questions for you. You can have a look, understand, and you can write back to me. And having understood the embedded software testing 5 units, we know that different complexity and different types of embedded systems can be tested in different approaches, like black box, white box, in terms of test approach, and in terms of test levels, we know that unit testing, integration system, and acceptance testing are part of the testing. So we studied about all that in different units, like fundamentals of testing, then testing methods, testing tools, and offline testing, static analysis, code inspection, code reviews. Then we studied about integrating the software and testing the integration aspects. Finally, we studied about the test management in terms of how the entire process of testing can be managed. It could be defects or it could be artifacts under the test. So related to all these units, all these 5 units, so we will have at least one or two examples, demonstration, lab sessions, questions and answers pertaining to these units. And accordingly, we will progress on embedded software testing modules. Okay. The first one being the first exercise, it is on test case design, test scenarios, and testing the embedded software. So we know that for doing the embedded software testing, it is a part of the life cycle, and the life cycle contains requirements, design, code, and test. And in order to test, we definitely need to have a requirement document. Okay, here is an example of SRS. So the first exercise is identify test cases and scenarios from a set of requirements with grouping test procedures. Example to consider for this is the SRS of UI. So this is an example created for this embedded software testing. It is called UI. UI is the thing about the embedded instrument, embedded unit instrument, which is a generic microcontroller instrument having certain features and functionalities, and it interfaces externally with certain messages. It is general unit. So we will try to understand the exercise and try to lay out answers for this exercise. So our aim is to create test cases and scenarios from the set of requirements. Okay, we will try to study the requirements. So what is the requirement? Okay, so this document is about requirement specification for embedded unit instrument. Okay, so this particular unit having about say 15 requirements, and there are a group of requirements. They are categorized into various features or functions. So the first group is about modes of operation. Next set of requirements is on performance requirements. The next set of requirements is about communication. The next set is about a watchdog. So likewise, we have about 1, 2, 3, 4 set of requirements. This is general requirement, whatever the beginning. So we'll try to do the testing of this. So as I said in one of the session, to have a embedded system testing done appropriately, to write the test cases, approach, and do the test design, and create the scenarios and do the execution. The first and foremost thing that we need to have is the system. System is what? The embedded software system. So that system we need to have a clear understanding. So how we can have an understanding? Based on the system understanding document or system spec. Here in this case we directly have the software requirements, and in general I will try to tell what the system is about. This system is an embedded unit instrument, so it works in different modes and it performs to some requirement, like it is supposed to have certain messages, it is supposed to have certain actions for certain messages, and it is supposed to work at certain speed, and it should have certain limitation in the memory, and how it can interface with the external world is explained in the communication requirement. And there is an additional unit called watchdog. So these are the top level elements of the embedded software system, and how it works over the period in the embedded software world or in the embedded system is that it works in 5 modes. Those are init, operational, maintenance, download, and fail. So you can see this diagram. This embedded system will be working in this one of the modes of operation when it is powered up until it is powered down or until it is used for different set of operations. So we have a to start with init mode, then it goes to your operational mode, then it can go to maintenance mode, or it can switch back to operational mode, and now maintenance mode it can further go to download mode. These are basic operations or basic modes of operations that this embedded unit instrument will work upon, and you can see the arrow specifically created so that accordingly the flow will happen. And from operational to init, there is no way to go back. Similarly, from download to maintenance, there is no way to go back. So there should be a requirement how we can go back to the init mode. So those are all called state level. So that sort of a complexity or that level of detail, let us try to see if we can detail future session, or let us try to keep it simplistic, saying that my embedded system is having this many operations and this much requirements. For this only I will try to write test case and understand how I can test it. That is the aim of this exercise. This is basically called as one more thing is that at any point of time, if during this 1, 2, 3, 4 modes of operation, the unit can go to a mode called fail mode. That means it is a failure. During initialization it could fail, during operational requirements or operational activities it can fail, or during maintenance and download operations it can go to a fail mode. So from the fail mode it will not go to any mode, it will be stuck or it will never be up. So in order to restart, probably user has to restart the system so that from fail mode it can recover from the init mode and go to operational. So basically any embedded systems you take will have 2 flow mechanisms, 2 levels of flow mechanism. One is initialization, other one is operation. Once it is initialized, it is good to operate or it is good to run. So in operational mode, whatever the specific requirements of that embedded system or the specific business requirements or the business objective or the client based requirements, it is supposed to work, it will work. So those two basically are the prime elements, but that is not sufficient in the embedded system because it needs to take care of many other things like failures, faults, that it should be maintainable, it should be downloadable, all this. So accordingly there are different operations or sub operations it will be added. So let us try to keep it simple saying that this embedded Unix instrument works in 5 modes of operation, and those are init, operation, maintenance and download, and at any point of time it can go to failure mode. Okay, having said that, so we have got a understanding on what this instrument does. So the first SRS or the first requirement, so basically requirements are identified with a tag called SRS, software requirement specification. The first one is talking about in general 5 modes of operation. Okay, the next requirement we will try to understand, it is basically under the category of modes of operation. So what are the modes that this instrument can go, and where and all it can go switch and backward. So you can see for each of that we have a separate requirement, like maintenance mode what will happen, operation mode what will happen, and in the initialization mode what will happen, and where it can go to failure mode. So it's very important to understand the requirement first. So let us try to understand to an extent what it is. Of course you can go through this offline and try to understand and can elaborate more your understanding, and when we are done with the test cases probably it will be a generic one or the basic ones which is enough to launch further to add more test cases. And we have studied in one of the classes of robustness, partition equivalence and analysis type of test cases, all this. So that can be elaborated further based on our expertise and when we dig more into the requirements, but generically we try to draw test cases for these set of requirements to start with. Okay, so SRS2 says about the UI shall set mode to failure mode in the following cases or logic. So what it means is the init will set the mode, so it different modes of operations are there, right? So it will set the mode to failure mode under the following conditions. So this condition can occur in any order or at any priority, that is why it is clearly told that it is a OR logic. OR logic means if this alone can happen, or this and this both can happen, or multiple of this can happen, or first, third, fourth, fifth, anything can happen. Any of this happens, it will enter into failure mode. So we need to draw a test case for this. What are the some level requirements for this? So these are all about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 types of cases are there. Each case will have its own requirement, like the when the embedded instrument is in maintenance mode it will go to failure mode, when the embedded instrument is in init mode it will go to fail mode, when it is in operational mode it can go to failure mode, right, when it is in download mode of course it will go to failure mode. So we know from this diagram that it can go to failure mode from either init, operational, maintenance and download. So 4 levels of entering into failure mode is there, that is what is been explained here. And further it could be different events, multiple events, like in maintenance we have 1, 2, 3 events are there which will be responsible for entering to failure mode. Similarly we have 2 events in init mode that can make it to the other mode. Similarly we have operational board as well. Okay. The next requirement is about when the board is in init mode, if status is okay. Let me explain any one more requirement here. When mod is in maintenance mode, if there is a message received equal to CR1LF, oh sorry 01CRLF, don't bother about what is CR, what is LF. Let us try to understand the first one. When mode is in maintenance mode, if received message is equal to 01CRLF. When mode is in maintenance mode, if received message is equal to 02CRLF. So when it is in maintenance mode, there are two events that can happen: 01CRLF, 02CRLF. Forget about what is CRLF and all. That is a message. So when the embedded init instrument receives a message having the content 01LF, 01CRLF, it should go to failure mode. Understood? Similarly, we have another case in maintenance mode. When the embedded init instrument is in maintenance mode, if the transmit message is not equal to CRLF, that means here we have received the message, and if the transmitted message from the embedded instrument has not become CRLF, this CRLF, it will go to failure mode. So similarly, in the initialization, if there is a error occurs or there is a error condition, it will also go to failure mode. Okay. So like this, we need to identify test cases. So definitely, we have 9 test cases, right? Because we have 9 sub requirements: 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So 9 definite test cases we have. Each test case we are going to provide an input as what? One is maintenance mode. Then we have to transmit a 01CRLF externally so that the unit receives 01CRLF, and we expect an output as failure mode. So these 3 elements are required for testing this. Likewise, we have the next one. We should make sure that the embedded instrument is in maintenance mode and we receive a message as 02CRLF, and we can expect the output as failure mode. Similarly, we have for everything the test cases are written, and interestingly, there is a OR logic. OR logic means what? Multiples of these events can occur. So we should be able to test with multiple events. That is event 1, event 2, event 3, and in the next test case we can have event 1, 2, 3, 4, and in the next case we can have all event 1, 2, 3, 4, 9. So combinations of these events is also very important, which is nothing but what we studied about is MCDC or the complete coverage of this requirement. So that we have covered this OR logic, so that OR of all this have been tested, OR of 1 or 2 also is tested. It does not mean that we should test for everything, every OR need not be required. It is just telling the OR logic. That is what we do with the partition equivalence. We try to test with first OR of first 2. Maybe in between one OR condition we can test, and in the last also we can test it, and the last case having OR for all this. The other important thing that we need to understand is whether is it viable to test it. Why I am telling is we know that this instrument can go in the mode, and that mode it will be there available. So is it possible for us to emulate all the modes at one instance? It may not be true. So in that case, we need to understand whether we will be able to do the inputs that can be triggered or not. if it is possible to trigger, then we should be able to do this OR logic. Since it is not possible, we will not be able to do it. So it is very important to understand the complete system logic and understand of the entire system so that it is easy to write. So 9 test cases definitely we can do it, and OR logic definitely we can do for certain cases, and OR logic for the entire case may not be possible because we may not be able to emulate. There are how many conditions? Maintenance is one, init is one, operational mode is one, download mode is one. So 4 modes we should be able to emulate at a time. Is it possible? I don't think so. So we should limit our test cases according to the need of the system, and though the test case is valid, we should try to understand whether is it possible to test it. That's what is this requirement is about. Okay, the next one. SRS3, when the mode is in initialization mode, now we are coming to individual modes basically in terms of its power up and other things. So when mode is in init mode, if status is no error state, the UI shall set the mode to operational mode. We know that it will go to failure mode when the initialization becomes failure or there is an error in the initialization, it will go to what? Failure, correct na? So the opposite of this, so you may be having a negative case for this in this test case only. So it is also important, I tell you, not to just have the positive values of 0 1 here and there. You should be able to scramble like this one as CR something like CRLF 10. So different type of messages we should be able to provide like this, you can have it, which is other than what is specified here. So that is a negative test case, or other than the entire OR operations, something like that. So anyway, we may not be able to have an answer what will happen if this is in not an error state, if the initialization is successful, right. So that is what is this requirement talks about. When the mode is in init mode, if the status, that means the operations of the initialization having no errors, the instrument shall set the mode to operational mode, that means it has moved to operational because initialization is successful. If it is failure, it would have gone to failure. That is what this requirement is about. So once we have understood this, it is easy to write. So trigger inputs with a failure case, trigger input with a successful case, 2 cases are done. And any other case we are missing? Okay, let us try to understand this one. When mode is in init mode, if no error state is alive less than 1 second, that means if initialization, if it is stuck for more than a second but there is no failure, that means error is not there, still it will go to a failure. That means what is the understanding? First case is initialization is happening and some failure has occurred in the initialization and that will lead to failure mode, and during initialization, initialization is complete, it is successful, it will go to operational. Now the third case, we have a initialization with no error, initialization is successful but it is not able to go to operational due to some issues or some other thing. You can call it as initialization failure but it is not an initialization failure because the error set for that is no error. So still it is a failure, it will again go to failure. Why? Because it is not able to go to operation within certain time. What is that time? 1 second. So this is another case. This is a typical embedded system requirement. I have taken photo. This is from the one of the example embedded instrument that I have picked up from my experience, and generically I try to put it. So nothing intentional for any application or anything, you can draw it to a different application, whatever it is. it is one of the example. Okay. Further understanding about this init mode. If the status is no error, then you go to operational mode conditionally. What are those conditions? When the mode is in init mode, if status is no error state, when mode is maintenance mode, if received message is equal to 03 CRNF. When mode is in maintenance mode, if transmitted message is equal to CRLF. When mode is in operational mode, the next requirement, if maintenance mode command state becomes equal to enable, VI shall set mode to maintenance mode. When mode is in operational mode, if maintenance status is enabled, when mode is in operational mode, if maintenance enable status alive at least 1 second. It is all similar requirement but specific to different modes. So this is how the requirements we need to understand and try to understand the entire system. This is about operational requirement. This is the entire operations, how different modes of operations are there. Any other things that we have missed? Probably the download mode of operations is not put here, I think. Yes. So under what conditions it will go to download? Okay, it is here actually. So download itself will go from maintenance. Why? Because it can go for only from maintenance. So there is a requirement here. So understand this requirement. We'll try to draw few requirements, some cases, so it's clear for you. When mode is in maintenance mode, definitely, if received message is equal to 04 CRLF, the unit shall set the mode to download mode. That means it has accepted this message and it is good to go for download operation. Then continuation of the requirement, actually, okay, I will tell that, wait for 1 second to enter into perform download method. That means once it enters into download mode, you should wait for 1 second to enter into download mode of activities. And sub conditions are, when mode is in maintenance mode, if received messages are equal to CRNF, when mode is in maintenance mode, if you wait 1 second. So these two are sub level requirements for this entire requirement. So this is how the requirement should be understood and try to draw test cases. Okay, the next set of requirement, performance requirement. The entire process of booting up till operational mode shall take not more than 1 second. So you know what is boot. So when the embedded system is powered on, it will be booted. It means it will be powered up. All the components, all the peripherals, or all the elements that are part of the embedded system will be powered up. And the time it requires to make it up and running, till then whatever is going to happen, it is nothing but booting. The process is called booting process. So here is the requirement, the entire process of booting up till it becomes operational should not take more than 1 second. Actually speaking, there are words actually which you should be careful, shall, should, will, may, etc. So each one has its own meaning basically. I will try to probably explain one of the parts, or it is part of the requirements understanding actually. This is not part of the embedded software testing, but it is better to have an understanding on these words. Shall means compulsorily the requirement should be tested, or the requirement should be implemented. At that level you try to understand. Okay. Okay, come back to performance requirements. So these are all performance related of the embedded systems. There are about 3, 4 or 5 requirements are there. The first one, the 7th one, is the entire process of booting up till operation mode shall take not more than 1 second. That means once you power on the system, once it becomes operational, the duration at which this is becoming operational should happen by less than 1 second. that is the meaning. So this is a bit challenging to understand first. Second thing is you may come up with a lot of questions before you try to start asking how I can test it. It is very important. So we need to understand what is booting up process, what is the operational mode, when I can say that it is operational mode, and what are the hooks. Or what is the strategy that I can apply to test this requirement. So in general embedded systems will have boot up identification, operational identification. Again these are derived from the requirements. So your first questions should be, first and foremost questions should be on the these things, like how I can identify whether it is booting, how I can identify whether it is operational. If these two are answered, your above requirement is clear, or the testing for the above requirement is clear, the strategy for working out there. So probably this requirement at this level it is very generic, so probably we can draw sub level requirements. I am just trying to put it actually, because I have not put the sub level, or is also called as derived requirement, whatever you want to say. So that can have something like the boot up identification or the boot up process starts when there is power cycle at pin number 20. Similarly, there could be operational requirements. One of the operational requirements we should be able to identify saying that it is operational. So probably we will try to understand the requirement. Yeah, communication requirements we have. So this will happen during operational requirement. So what it says is the UA shall communicate through CAN message the outside interface. That means one of the interface requirements should be able to identify operational requirement. So it is clear right now, with these two we should be able to test it. Again, next question is how we can test it. So there are certain things like there is a 1 second, that means we need to measure the time, it is very clear, correct? No? So time, how we can measure? Time to be measured, how we can measure with the help of measuring instrument such as oscilloscope, right? Okay, to measure a duration, how many hooks you need? 2, because one at the start, one at the required end, basically you can call it. So one at the booting up identification time, other one is at the operational mode. So we have a pin number 20, the first one being pin 20. Pin 20 we should have one hookup, the second one should be interface hookup. So interface requirement, as we said in the beginning, here CAN message. CAN message, basically we need to identify the CAN port, it is a hardware interface. There we can put the oscilloscope, or we can very well see the message analyzers are there, such as CANalyzer or CANscope, etc. Any of these instrument can be used. So there is a, how we can measure now with this definitely pin 20 oscilloscope starts showing the wave basically, and we record the time, it is called as start time. Right. Similarly, here we record the message receive time in the CAN, because both are running at the same system. We know that the time log or time, this is called time log or timestamp of this. So the net duration of this timestamp equal to message receive time minus start time. So this is very clear. This should not be, or this should be less than 1 second. So our requirement is tested. So like this, we should be able to test this requirements. This is, this will become a strategy, test strategy. Got it? So we identify the test case to measure this and make sure that at any point of time when we boot up, it should not exceed the 1 second limit, otherwise the requirement has failed. So we should be having a questions in terms of how we can have identify the test hooks for testing this, and what are the measuring items that we can have for this performance requirement. Similarly, we have a the next one called the processor workload for the worst case shall not exceed 100%. So here there are different jargons, embedded system jargons that we have. One is processor, other one is workload. It is also called as execution cycle, and another one is worst case, other one is percentage. Right, so we need to first understand what processor is used. It could be any microcontroller. If the microcontroller, suppose any power PC or Freescale, let's say power PC example, MPC 5556, if it is used, so we need to have a data sheet. So we know that at what rate it is running. That means at certain cycles of speed the processor is capable of executing, right. Once we know that this is the execution, suppose if it is a 1 hertz, it is executing the instructions or the execution cycle at 1 second, because we know that time equals 1 by f. So f is a frequency, t is a time. So 1 hertz means 1 second. Similarly, 1 megahertz is 1 into 10 to the power of 6. So like this, we are going to have the processor details first, then workload, that means how many instructions it can execute. So if it is 10 megahertz equals 10 million cycles per second it can execute. Then worst case, so worst case we have defined, that means at max not more than this, that means 10 million per second, that is the worst case, or you can say also equal, worst case it can go to 10 millions per second. Generally it will not go that much, but if the load means the activities or the interactions or the operations that are happening within the microcontroller or the processor is so high that the entire processor is completely loaded, completely occupied. You can see in Windows and all that there is something called a taskbar, task manager. You can see the load here, networking basically, it can say a processor, I would say performance, let's go. So here is one performance requirement for this processor, whatever I have. I hope you are able to see this. Okay. Here you can see the performance, the CPU usage. See, this is a bar, right? Complete bar. So currently, as I speak, so there is the audio recorded. There is a typing word. So many things are happening in the Windows, and at every instance, there is a percentage that is getting changed, right? You can see 47%, 54%, 40%. Every instance it is showing. Accordingly, it is graphing this side. So this they have captured using the instruction cycle. So how many instructions are getting used in the CPU? This is an Intel based CPU. So 43%. Similarly, for this embedded instrument, in it, we cannot afford to have a more than 75%. That means we should have a program or the entire embedded systems developed in such a way that we will not be loading the application more than 75%. That solves the understanding of this. And there are other things like page file usage, cache, handle, so many things, all ATOS or I would say operating system related things. Let us not look into that in details. When you come across memory and those things, probably you will come to know about this. So that is what the basic concept of workload of the processor, and the percentage is 75%. This is the formula we use for calculations. So just for understanding, I have put here. The question is how you can measure. Like, we have task manager in Windows, but in embedded systems, do we have any task manager? We may not have. So the requirement should be much clearer and more detailed, such that the workload, how it can be tested, that is what is called as testability. Testability of this requirement, what is it? It is, I would say, no, none. That means it cannot be tested at this by seeing the requirement just like this. So we may have to dig further into other requirements to understand what can be done and what can be used, which requirement I can correlate so that this testability can be applied. So that is also important, because there are multiple teams working on different requirements, like performance requirements. Some one person is working, communication one person, watchdog one person. They need to have an interaction such that each one is very clear of what they are doing, as well as how others are doing their testing. So it is very important to understand the system from that perspective. Usually, in general, what they do is they use the map file. Probably I will go through the map file, how it looks like. The entire execution of the processor is divided into various tasks, right? And we know that each task, what the time is going to take. So collection of all these tasks equal to the total time, and where we can get the tasks, we can get in the map file. How we can generate the map file? Based on the linker linking on the target. So collection of all this total time will become the total time of the all the tasks. So again, the total time that is available based on this formula we are going to derive it. So this is how we can write the test case for this particular one. The next one is the memory. Similar to this, we can use the map file for testing the memory. Like we know that there is a 1 MB of flash memory available, and how much memory is being occupied by the embedded unit instrument. It should not exceed 50%. That means 500, what is the half of or is the 50% of 1 MB? Equal to 500 KB. Right. So this is how we are going to measure the size. Where we can see the size, it is based on the map file of a typical, this is a typical embedded system I am trying to talk. There could be different ways we can see, or the actual L file, a linker file, or the definition of the linker, or it could be S record, or it's executable size. Basically, this is the size. So that itself will tell you how much it is going to occupy the memory. Based on that, we know that what is my total size of the instrument or the embedded system, and how much is being occupied. So if it is more than 500 KB, that means this requirement has failed. And if it is less than, if it is more than 500 KB, requirement has failed. Else, requirement is passed. This is how we are going to write the test case and do an analysis and arrive at the conclusion. So basically, these are something like the method that we use using analysis. These methods are called as analysis, especially for performance requirements are done with analysis. Analysis of memory, analysis of map file, linker, and the memory and the data sheets and all this stuff will be part of it. So other part of a memory is RAM. That also should not be more than 50%. So this also can be done with the help of the contents that is defined in the linker and the corresponding map file. So that will tell how much memory this embedded unit has got produced. Another part is the stack. You know what is stack? So the stack memory should have a reserve of 50%. The next type of requirement is about communication requirement. Okay, you know what is communication? It is communication between two elements of the embedded software. It could be subsystems or it could be a system versus external world. So in this case, what is that we have? Let's try to understand. The communication SRS-12 requirement is about the UI shall communicate through CAN message with outside interface. That means this unit will interact with outside world with CAN message. So this you need to test it. This is a very simple requirement. How you can test it? You can inspect the CAN message whether it is coming out of the or analyze the coming out of the instrument. That will prove that this requirement is satisfied. That means embedded unit instrument is transmitting the message or communicating with the external world. That's all is the requirement. So we'll prove with that there could be some tools required to analyze the CAN messages, right? So what are the CAN messages? That is all probably for the next set of requirements. I will try to understand like whether it is a 02s, CRLF. We know that there are different modes of operations. It will transmit. Alive message you can see here. So there is a alive message which it will transmit, and those alive messages can be observed in the CAN at regular interval. So there is a requirement saying that every 1 second the messages are analyzed, correct? So using a tool something like CANalyzer, we can see that there is a message coming out of the embedded unit instrument. So this is what we are going to prove. So with that, this test case is written, and inputs we know, output we can expect, and we can do the testing. The next requirement, UI shall communicate its alive status at least once. Yeah, exactly. Already it is there below. So together we can test this requirement with the above one, or while testing this testing also can be taken care of, right? So test cases, switch off, sorry, let's start with switch on. simpler one. Switch on the EUI, wait for 1 second, expect the CAN message or CAN, what is that called, alive status every second. Next is switch on, switch off the EUI equal to no, expect no CAN alive message. So these are the case, that is all, very simple. So two test cases we can draw out of this requirement. This is about communication requirements, but this is a simpler one I have put. There could be a more complicated ones where you need to combine, as I said, in the operational mode different requirements. That is called as a grouping of the requirements. Here I have grouped both the requirements I have, all right, 12 and 13, grouping of requirements, or I would say grouping of test cases to address the multiple requirements. So best and good thing that we can adopt is plainly you write the test cases first. You take one by one, write the test case for this, write the test case for this, assuming some other requirement, then you group all of them under communication requirements. That will become a perfect test strategy for communication requirements. So that test strategy will have communication requirements related test cases. That is how we can take care of that. Okay. So next one is about watchdog requirements. You know watchdog by now, I mean it is part of the embedded systems, that is an independent unit. It could be an internal watchdog or external watchdog. Its basic job is to make sure that the processor and the software that is working inside the software is alive and it is working all the time, and if it is not working, this watchdog will do a reset of that processor. That's all it does. So to do that, it will have requirement in terms of at what rate it should reset, at what rate it should monitor, etc. So that's why it is called as a watchdog. It basically watches. So if the embedded unit instrument is not alive, it will try to reset, and if it is alive, it will not bark. Here that is why the name came as a dog actually. So to satisfy the dog, you need to make sure that you are alive, and that alive should be monitored by the watchdog unit. Okay, let us not go in deep into watchdog because I hope this explanation is enough for now. Okay, let us try to understand two requirements so that we can write the test cases easily. Okay, the EUI shall configure the internal watchdog to generate a reset to the microcontroller with threshold duration of 500 milliseconds. So as I said, so watchdog is should be configured, right? The configuration when it is done during the initialization. So the configuration of the watchdog should be done such that it is configured at 500 milliseconds. The watchdog is configured for 500 milliseconds. So when the microcontroller is reset, if the watchdog generate pulse duration of greater than 500 milliseconds. So the watchdog unit internally will wait for 500 milliseconds and it will do a reset after the 500 milliseconds. It will generate a pulse basically. Okay. The embedded unit instrument shall pulse the internal watchdog at least once every 500 milliseconds or less. You know why? Because watchdog unit will know that the microcontroller threshold still it is making it happy that next 500 milliseconds it can execute its operations, and in between it is going to pulse watchdog so that there is no reset occurred, and it is clear that the embedded unit instrument is working fine. So when microcontroller operations are running continuously, if watchdog generate pulse at least once every 500 milliseconds or less. That means if microcontroller operations are running for a long time, more than 500 milliseconds, it will going to reset it, and the microcontroller's responsibility is to make sure that it should pulse the watchdog so that there is no reset occurring. So that is what the meaning of the watchdog. This is the internal watchdog what I tried to put it. Okay. So that is what the understanding of the requirement. So we should be very clear about the system. If it is a complex system, definitely we need to have a generic idea. Then what are the modules that we are working for the embedded software testing, that modules at least and surrounding modules we should be clear of how it is going to be operated, what are the requirements, and what are the references that I need to know. For the, for example, in this case we need to have a reference of the embedded processor, which processor I am using, so which pin I need to go through and how I can use it, what are the instruments that I need, that is also very important to arrive at the strategy. So it is very important to understand the requirements first, then based on that we can go through the, we can write the test cases. Okay. In the next session we will try to identify the test cases and try to understand the test cases, and for these requirements we will write the scenarios and try to group the test cases for the functionality or the feature set of the requirements. So exercise 1 is about understand the requirements, write the test cases and scenarios from the set of requirements with grouping. An example to consider is the SRS for the embedded unit instrument, and extension of the this exercise is once we are done with the requirement understanding and test cases writing, we should be able to write the test case review checklist, test review checklist it is called, for high level testing, because we are doing the requirement based testing, because this checklist is very important. I will try to open it. These are the rules for verification of test cases. So what we do basically here is this checklist will make sure that our verification is strong and correct for the given requirements. So that is what we will try to do it, and if there is no, then we need to provide a comment. If there is yes, it is fine, you have taken care of this checklist, and if it is not applicable, we need to provide a comment why it is not applicable. So this is also an exercise we need to fill up this column as well as this one. So we will try to go through this in the next session of this exercise. After that we will try to understand the traceability as the exercise 2, and we have more exercises like exercise 3 for coverage tool using VLD array. We will try to understand the coverage tool, then LD array extension unit testing we will try to understand. Then the next class is about next exercise is about code warrior, that is another IDE, Internet Development Environment. The next one is about few lab sessions for the YouTube, Google. We will try to understand from various embedded projects how they are using it. The last exercise set is being on the test case management and defect management using TestLink and Bugzilla. And the foremost or the last one is the static analysis using understand C++. The tool will try to follow it. So with that we will end today's session, and we will continue the exercise 1 and 2 in the next session.